All right, take two. So this is my podcast and kind of a rough start, but thank you for joining with me and bearing with me as I try to make this thing happen. You may have seen some of my earlier work on podcasting, mostly focused on politics. I'm kind of done with that. This is Jason Everett Miller's Guide to Being Human. Obviously, that's a big topic, and the only lens that any one person can really view that topic through is their own. So, when my son was on his way, I had been out of work for a minute and lots of time on my hands and no small amount of whiskey. So I put myself up in the basement, my basement office, and started writing what would become a self-published autobiography called Midnight Sun. And fast forward 3 years, I ended up with about 645 pages and an 18-month-old. And I was living here in Minneapolis, having left Portland, having started a novel in Washington, D.C. That's sort of what I'll be using as the basis for my exploration of what it means to be human. I figure by bearing my soul to y'all, one chapter at a time, starting with my earliest memory, of which you can go out and check out right now at gemsguide.com. That's J-E-M-S guide.com, Gems Guide. I'll be publishing them a chapter, three chapters at a time, every 2 weeks on this show. I'll read each chapter in turn and talk about some things that made it to my list. Here's a view of that. Also on the website, that's tucked inside of the non sequiturs. Hello world. You'll find what we're talking about today. I was trying to log out, but it won't let me log out. Going too fast. I'll be talking about going too fast. We'll be slowing down. I'll also be reading chapters 1, 2, and 3. Hopefully some people will call in on the Hangout, which is open. I posted a link to that as well in the Facebook page, but I will post a link on my own page as well. And yeah, so that's pretty much the format. What we'll be doing today, hopefully if someone pops into the Hangout, we can have a discussion. In the meantime, I'll be going through my list. There's 21 items, and I guess we'll just sort of get to it. So first on my list is the show open, which we just did. you know what? We'll go ahead and read the first chapter first, then we'll get to, 21, three chapters. So we'll do 7 of these items. I'll read a chapter, 7, read a chapter, 7, read a chapter. Okay, that'll work. So number 2, dystopia versus utopia. So there's this thing I read about called the dual timeline theory. And basically what the philosophy people who came up with it, I guess I didn't really look into who came up with it, but I read this thing about it. And their theory is that because of possibly an infinite number of universes and an infinite number of realities, that when one reality gets to such a dichotomy in belief structures, that one reality splits into two separate realities. And I feel like that's what we're living through right now. We have a lot of people, mostly on the younger end of the spectrum, who believe that utopia is still possible in, you know, whatever fashion that makes sense for them. And then a number of people, mainly on the older end of the spectrum, or people with power, see the future as a dystopia that you know, it's always going to be the strong taking over the weak. It's always going to be survival of the fittest, a zero-sum game for everybody involved. And you know, I fall into the utopia camp. I've put it this way. I think it's a bunch of people hoping that we reach Mad Max, and it's a bunch of people hoping we reach Star Trek. And I'm going for Star Trek. And I think a lot of people, probably people who are watching this show, by and large, hope we head towards Star Trek as well. Plus, I have a kid who's going to be 5 soon, and you know, I have no hope but to be optimistic for the future. What am I going to leave him otherwise? A big pile of shit. That's kind of what was left us. Which leads me to generational turnover, number 3 on my list. And I coined a hashtag, not me, because whenever you talk about anything that has to do with any generation, the first thing they shout is not me. And generally speaking, that's the boomers shouting not me, because generally speaking, people, when looking to assign blame and apportion blame, look to the people who have the most power. And right now, that's the boomers. They, you know, they're at the older end of the generation. They lived in a very different time, where you know, acquiring a wealth was a little bit easier of a prospect. And so the first thing a lot, and I'm not saying all, my mom, you know, largely agrees with me about her generation and sort of the things they squandered. Let's see, somebody's doing something, messaging me or something. I can't get to it. Let me see here, one sec. Oh, someone who sends me things quite a bit, actually. So not important to the show, but the hangout's still there. Let me throw that link out on my Facebook. Going slow, one sec. So, I guess I should attach a picture to that. All right, so I just popped that out there. If you see the link from my Facebook, Jason Everett Miller. Hey, what's up, man?
Hey, how you doing?
Good. Let me figure out some audio. You got a lot of fuzz in your background. You got music playing? Oh yeah, you can't watch me on the Facebook because there's a delay.
Yeah.
Not that I'm watching my language or anything.
Yeah.
I just hear music on your side, that's what I'm hearing.
That's the Oscars.
Yeah. That's okay. I fully expected most of these early shows to be. This is what I'm trying. This is my friend Donald, who is a regular of the Artisan Politics program. But I'll be honest, I'm just done talking about politics. To be honest,
Oh, that's fine.
There'll be bits and pieces as it relates to the larger story of being human, but just the show. It was just got really repetitive. It's the same shit all the time. So. We still got quite a bit of feedback on your side, though. I'm gonna try to. All right, that's. I think that's dialing in there a little bit. So how are things? Nice. Yeah, a little bit of culture shock. Yeah. Right on. I'm still trying to figure out why I can't get your audio. I don't even know if anybody's hearing your audio on the actual stream. No, that's not working. I mean, I can get you if I put you on the speakers and then we hear you that way. Thanks for being a guinea pig as always. I appreciate it. I need to do some more tests on this, I think.
So that's the general gist of the podcast.
So, I mean, the general gist of the show is I make a list of 21 things that I've kind of figured out over the years. I was talking about generational turnover a little bit. I was going to go into false equivalence and false dichotomy, which plays into every part of our lives. Talk about slowing down, taking each moment as like a series of steps. And if you find that things in your life tend to go awry or that you're not always firing on all cylinders, it's probably because you're just going a little too fast for your existence. You just need to slow it down a half a beat or a couple beats and take your time. Slow is fast, as the Navy SEALs say, and that is, you know, makes a lot of sense to me. And it, again, relatively recent. Even as far as today, you know, I did something, and I'm like, ah, that didn't turn out the way I was expecting. And then I take a breath, and go, oh, I missed this step and this step because I was thinking about, you know, what I had to do instead of what I was doing. So it's stuff like that. Basically, the idea is Midnight Sun was everything I would have liked to be able to tell my son over the years, if I died tomorrow. And it's kind of morbid, but, you know, that's, you know, what you think about that when you have kids, obviously. And then this show is going to be a continuation of that, but more like this. So, volume one is my autobiography. Volume two will likely be all these conversations that happen as I publish my autobiography over the next year. So, sort of a one-year time horizon on volume one. And then volume two, right now, I'm hoping volume two grows out of these conversations and becomes more of about everybody else's story except mine. And then I'll just sort of have those discussions. So, like mini serial memoir might be a way to look at it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Basically, what prompted it was I got let go from a contract opportunity sooner than I was expecting. definitely sooner than I needed it to be. So now I'm back on the job market looking for a day job. But who knows how long that's going to take, right? The last one took a year. So I feel like, you know, I can turn this show into a funded effort via using various fundraising mechanisms. Starting with Indiegogo tomorrow. And then get my consulting firm stood up, start doing websites and web maintenance for small businesses and stuff. And dude, if they're forcing me to live in the gig economy, I got to figure out how to string together several gigs to equal, you know, my minimum monthly sort of requirements. And I feel like I can do that.
Yeah.
And if I can do it quick enough, then, you know, shit, I won't even have to work for anybody else, which is really probably where I should be anyway. So we'll see. I'm feeling pretty good about it. Like, the whole idea came to me like an epiphany. It just full whole cloth in my head all at once last week. And then this job ends, and then, you know, like everything, you know, it's just everything. You go through moments in your life where you're open to epiphany. A lot of times the reason,
yeah,
you miss opportunities is because you're just not open to seeing them the way you might see them otherwise. And, you know, there's nothing like a little existential crisis to lead somebody towards, you know, hey, maybe I should just go, you know, lean into the skid this time and just do whatever I have to do, hustle. You know, I'll walk dogs, dude. I'll do Rover. Like, I just, every little bit, you know, extend the runway, you know?
Yeah. It's funny, I'm kind of surprised my wife by taking this position down here, because it's 6 hours away from here, so 3 hours away from there. You know, so I want to drive a lot further to go visit, so I haven't visited as often, you know. She, I don't know if I told you this last time, but she takes care of her, you know, she never taken care of her mom, and now she's taking care of her aunt, who just turned 99 years old. Half a week, you know, she stays over and takes care of her aunt, and they get along very well. You know, it's not a real chore for her, you know, but it is work. So when she has experience,
yeah,
as a caregiver, so she was a kind of natural choice to help out. And so she's there in Hamilton here. And so we signed a lot. But yeah, so I took this job, and she was kind of like, well, I'm sure you're not having a midlife crisis. And I said, well, I totally have a midlife crisis. I'm past midlife, you know. But one thing I was thinking back, it's kind of a weird thing, you know. Last spring, I was kind of feeling that I was kind of stuck in the job. And there were things happening with the job that I wasn't too happy about. Other people were getting promoted, you know. And I thought I was doing good work. You know, they said I was doing good work for promoting other people. And of all things, I grew up in a tennis fan. And I watched this thing trying to raise by one of the French Open last year. This tiny girl moving someone to help who just never gives up. And she just kept trying and trying to mention she won the major. And it was kind of an odd thing for this next story, but I did find it kind of inspiring. That she, even though she was not big with lots of big weapons, she hung in there and she made it happen. And she, and it was kind of, I kind of looked at her and I said, nothing's going to get ahead to me if I'm going to have to find more opportunities. And I was kind of glad I was talking about that. This one kind of fell into my lap because of how the theater kind of works this firm. And she just happened to put up, on LinkedIn saying, hey, we're looking for a project manager and a campus planner. And I thought, that's really weird. I didn't need a woman in architecture, but she's not. She's in a firm that has architecture as well as functions. So I interviewed in Kenner, Indiana, Wisconsin, because they have an office in Wisconsin as well. And then I got the job, so that's great. And so that is interesting. I was in kind of that kind of moment where it kind of inspired me to think that, so I'm telling myself I could change things and make things better with this one kind of.
Yeah, for sure. I hear you. I've been in a similar situation several times.
Yeah.
Not the exact same thing, but. All right. Well, hey, I'm gonna go ahead.
Yeah. No, that's fine. Sometimes you surprise yourself, so that's cool. So.
Right on. All right, man. So, well, thanks for calling.
I don't think you're going to be able to next.
What's that? I really appreciate it. I'm happy to get at least one caller tonight.
Yeah, so I hope it goes well. I'll follow up with the one of you guys somewhere with the bus on YouTube or whatever. I'll take a look.
Cool, yeah, thanks. I'll be posting it on YouTube after it's all done.
Okay.
All right. And also, always feel free to comment on the blog too, because it'll be this blog will be a living sort of document as well.
Sure.
All right, man.
Okay.
Thanks again. I appreciate it. Good luck. Have a good one. Take care. Bye bye. All right. Thanks, Donald, for calling in. That's a little taste of what I was hoping to have happen. Gonna have to figure out the audio issues. I gotta have a way to get the audio into the control panel here, but it's not doing that, so we'll get to that next time. And now I'm backwards here. There we go. So we talked a little bit about generational turnover. No more, not me. So basically, my thoughts are we can just all sort of take responsibility for whatever it is, whoever thinks, whatever is our fault, and it doesn't matter because moving forward, it's going to be a very finite set of solutions. We need to be solution agnostic and really blame agnostic because at this point, it doesn't matter who's at fault. It matters what we do next. Got into this with Donald just a little bit. False equivalency and false dichotomy. And basically, that's either or, neither nor, and both is bullshit because both are bullshit. Because false equivalence basically says, when they say both parties are the same, right? Not true. False dichotomy, you have to choose that party or this party. Not true. The media largely, but even in our own personal relationships, choices get boiled down to either or, neither nor propositions and, zero sum games, even in times when, it's an interpersonal relationship, which is just really sad to me. So I talked a little bit about slowing down, and that's, that's something that I've been doing in my own life, I guess about about a week now. it occurred to me that I had been moving too quickly and was kind of anxious about not getting everything done or whatever it was I was doing. I was thinking about the thing I had to do next, and kind of rushing through whatever it was I was doing. And oftentimes it didn't happen right the first time. And many times I just keep doing it wrong over and over again, going, why isn't this thing working? How often do you do that in your life? All the time. So I've started like, okay, when I go to do anything, it doesn't matter what it is, putting on my pants, opening the fridge, whatever. If I, go to grab something out of the fridge and like something else is in the way, I don't try to grab that thing exactly the same way again. I stop, look, see what the impediment is, move the impediment, get the thing. Oftentimes you sit there and try it two or three times, and it takes you two or three times as long if you had just slowed down to begin with. So that's kind of, an ongoing philosophical thing that I'm trying to make work. Oh, I gotta open up the Hangout again. Hang on. I think I closed it. All right. It's gonna be a different link. Let me see if I can update that bit.ly. Update the existing. Maybe. Just join the same one. Cool. All right. So the Hangout is open for business again. Let's see if we can figure that one out. Me see. All right, that's open. Six, unlikely voters versus likely voters. And that goes to number three, which is generational turnover. So one reason why things really have not changed much, at least in the 10 years that I've been watching politics religiously, is that the same people vote. It's generally voters over 50 are the ones that show up 60, 70% of the time. Whereas voters under 50, who equal two-thirds of the electorate, show up 30% or less. And you can see how calcified our system of government has gotten. And it's really under assault by a whole generation of people who don't trust government, who were told that government is the enemy. And then government services get broke. Nobody pays attention. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. That's how Rome goes down in flames. So we can stop it in its tracks right now. And really, beyond politics, what our inattention to sort of the basic obligations of living in a civil society is now we're all focused on buying things, all of our stuff. There's an infinite variety of all these different products. But really, we should find our variety in people. And I think that paradigm's starting to come into its own, where people, cherish, maybe older stuff because it lasts longer, because it was made right. It wasn't made by slave labor. I have some ideas about how can we be more mindful in how we purchase things. Caveat emptor, buyer beware. Well, we have really not been all that aware about a great number of things. First of which, the things we buy, and what we find to be important. So that brings us to the end of the first seven. We'll go ahead and read the first chapter of Volume 1, Midnight Sun, The Walrus. Dismissing painful details started out as a defense mechanism, I suspect, but quickly became a genetic trait, as ingrained as my black hair, hazel eyes, and crooked smile. Subplots of fear and powerlessness lack any real substance, the half-felt spasms of phantom memories severed decades in the past. The short time I spent on the streets of hell as a kid seems more like a vivid nightmare now than horrific events I barely survived. If I hadn't actually lived my life, I'd think I was full of shit too. The first thing I remember is snuggling with my mom and little sister on a small couch under a thick quilt high in the mountains of Colorado. Summit County, Colorado, rather. With a large bowl of buttered popcorn balanced between us, we watched the Beatles' animated live-action film, Yellow Submarine. Google dates the memory as October of 1972, when CBS aired the U.S. television premiere to a waiting audience of Beatles fanatics. The movie was one of the few shows broadcast in color at the time, though our little black-and-white set couldn't make the distinction, and we really didn't notice. I was 2.5 years old. We lived in a one-bedroom, one-bath apartment with a kitchen and a living room combination filling the rest of the minimal square footage. Bric-a-brac gathered at thrift stores and garage sales was customized and commingled to create a living diorama that moved from surface to surface, tracing the short and adventurous journey we had taken thus far. Sentimentality transformed into social commentary, like the traditional Japanese art of kintsukuri, where cracked pottery is repaired with melted gold, the resulting work considered more rare and more valuable than an undamaged original. Our apartment was the bottom floor of a converted garage without a house in sight for it to belong to. A second unit upstairs was reached via wooden steps to a small deck and sliding glass doors. It was a homey building ringed by the majestic peaks of the Rockies and a barren field waiting for a spring an entire winter away from being sprung. The hippies upstairs also longed for the emptiness around us to turn into a field of technicolor given the amount of poppy tea they brewed in 5-gallon pickle jars lined up on their balcony all summer long. Sun transforming water and pistols into God's own beverage of choice. Mom says the hippies, I remember, were actually a gay couple who were home most of the time with no obvious source of income. So I suspect they gently scored the immature bulbs months before the flower explosion to call forth the raw materials of a more potent and lucrative brew. My first exposure to the entrepreneurial lifestyle, as it turns out. I don't recall many details beyond the kid-friendly tea, but flashing lights and firemen made an appearance one night when the couple paired magic mushrooms with an hibachi grill and burned the place to the ground, but not before getting us all to safety. My mom still laments the loss of the little TV we gathered around as a new family. She finally managed to buy one after saving for months, and it was gone in a flash of drug-fueled negligence. Over the years, we would try to separate the smoke-stained photos that melted together that night, those lingering memories from the first time we escaped with only each other and our lives would rip away from the crooked stacks, leaving half-shredded images behind as a bittersweet reward. Movement has been a constant companion of mine, much of it in darkness and most without warning. Physical and emotional evolution at a speed that would make both Jesus and Darwin proud, given the variables involved. This early exodus would be the first of more than a dozen moves before I landed at Job Corps in Reno, Nevada at the age of 17, after being kicked out of all three high schools in Yuba City, California the year before. It wasn't my first move, actually, only the first one I can remember. Mom says I was just a mass of dividing cells when she and my father drove their maroon 1967 Barracuda from Middleton, Wisconsin to Anchorage, Alaska. Every time we talk about that drive of theirs along the Alaskan Canadian Highway in the summer of 1969, she mentions how the same style car just sold at auction for nearly $1 million. I like the story of how they left Alaska a year later in an overloaded VW bus that blew an engine at mile marker 604 just outside of Watson Lake in Canada's Yukon Territory. As miracles go, the 16-wheeler that showed up after a couple of tense hours was a good one. The copious tears on my dad's young cheeks dried promptly, and my mom's faith was renewed in the gods she was praying to just before their trucker savior showed up. So that's chapter one of volume one, Midnight Sun. All that rhymed unaccountably. The first installment of Jason Everett Miller's Guide to Being Human. So we'll read chapters 2 and 3. Still got some time here. We'll get right into number 8 on my list: moderating your tempo, minding your energy. So that kind of goes to number 5: slowing down, gaining time. Slow is fast. When you think about your tempo and how you walk through the world and how you interact with other people, they're going to be at different energy levels. Many times, especially in places like work or even in interpersonal relationships, one party is going to be at a different energy level than the other. Again, this is all relatively recent stuff, so I'm not trying to say like I've known this crap forever. I'll be 49 in April, and I just learned several of these in the last 2 weeks. Including this one. So if you can keep your energy at a moderate and sort of reasonable level, you can notice more details in these interactions, and you can respond more slowly to these. No matter what the other person is doing, it's not incumbent upon you to raise your energy level to be where they're at. If you keep it slow and moderate, you'll actually find you'll have more cogent responses. Maybe your responses won't make a bad situation worse. Perhaps you can start to make bad situations better. It's a process, baby steps. But moderating your tempo, and even to the point of like where you pause and let other people go first or whatever, like that's me. That's my thing. That may not be your thing, but because I usually move really, really fast. So to me, I'm like, you know, if I'm more of a sloth, less of a jaguar, it's having benefits in my life. And number 9, moderating your tone. And that kind of goes with the tempo, but also your tone of voice. Things get misconstrued very easily. And if you bring your tempo down, that means your emotions aren't at a heightened state, which means your tone is going to come down automatically. When in doubt, smile when you say that. You can disarm and get rid of a lot of bombs thrown if you realize quickly that you probably shouldn't have gone there. Smile and apologize. Number 10, the climate crisis. So we're just about out of time, people. It's since they really started making predictions. First it was things happening in 2100, then things were going to be happening in 2080, now 2070, now they're saying 12 years, freaking 2030, we hit tipping points in several different areas. That's not to say the game's over, but we really need to snap to it quickly. And that really goes back to number 7, what about all this stuff? Enough is too much. We're beyond the point where we can just keep consuming resources at such a furious pace in pursuit of crap, of products that don't work, that you're constantly buying over and over again, most of them that you don't even need. So the climate crisis is really going to throw us for a loop in the not too distant future. I am thankful that we now have Gen X, a decent portion of the boomers, a decent portion of Gen X, most of the millennials, and I'd hazard a guess the vast majority of Gen Z are all focused on climate and the climate crisis and how we can change our own lives, how we can do things differently in our own lives to affect that greater, that larger problem. And I have some ideas around that, how we can consume differently, how we can be more cognizant of passing feedback to the companies that rely on these sketchy supply chains and sell us broken shit. So, number 11, this really feeds into the climate crisis too. Kill your ego before it kills you. And humanity as a whole, kill our ego before it kills all of us. It doesn't matter who's right as long as what is right gets done. And that's an important distinction. Sometimes you're going to be right and you'll never get any acknowledgement that you're right. The best you can hope for is that things change, things get done differently. And you know what? A lot of times people will actually take credit for things you told them to do. they'll think it was their idea. And again, does it matter? It's really ego that says, hey, I need to get credit for that shit. As long as it's getting done, as long as people are doing the right thing, that's all that matters. Forget about who gets credit. It's bullshit. You know what? Everybody take credit for everything I've ever done or everything I will do, as long as I get paid. So number 12, take a break. We'll be right back. All right. I'll take a break. We'll be right back. All right, and we're back. Well, that was a quick break. All right, number 13. Oh, yeah, number 13. So we're going to 14, then I'll read chapter 2. So number 13, the employment outlook. So many jobs, no one can fill them all, question mark. Nope. So, I mean, this will likely be a dead horse that gets beaten on a lot of different episodes of this program, but I know too many people who have advanced degrees, lots of student loan debt, families, seemingly solid careers and at least seemingly solid career paths, but the way in which big companies especially fill jobs now are through these staffing agencies who are at a far remove. You got to work as a contractor in a lot of times with no benefits. Yeah, it's a decent hourly rate, but they can just get rid of you at any moment. Like I showed up 2 hours after I got there. They said, give us your security badge. Give us your computer. See ya. Thanks for everything. You can rely on us for a recommendation. Which I guess is great, but, you know, I wasn't expecting to be unemployed, whatever that was, last Wednesday, the 21st. So here we are on the 24th, 3 days later. Necessity is the mother of invention, so I've built a website and figured out what to do with my weighty tome that I wrote and figured I'd never publish. So yeah, how do we solve it? How do we get people working? I have no idea. If you got any ideas, log into the Google Hangout. The links on the website, links on my page. We'll figure it out together, but probably not. Yeah. 14, learning how to be a parent. And again, that the idea that I was becoming a father and my father was never really around and I didn't, you know, I heard some stories, but I didn't have as complete a picture of his life as I would have liked. And then, you know, he was gone too early at like 61 years old. So I, you know, came into that having just lost my father a couple years earlier, and saying, you know what, if I die unexpectedly, I want this kid to know who I am. So I wrote, 125,000 words trying to explain it. I think for the most part, I did a pretty good job of explaining it. The fact that I needed that many words is a little troubling, but hopefully, as the audience reads through my words, and hears them on this program, you'll agree that I have a story to tell, and I'm glad to have told it, and I'm happy to share it with y'all. So, without further ado, Escape Artist. Chapter 2, Escape Artist. At 3 and a half, I decided it was time I lived with my dad and set out to make it happen. That he lived hours away in Denver didn't deter me in the least. That I was watched both day, night and day made no difference at all. If anything, these obstacles made the adventure more exciting to contemplate. Go big or go bigger is a motto that has served me well throughout the years. First, though, the escape. Mom dropped us off at the sitter's house each morning and picked us up each night when she was done making lawyers look exceptional for the day as a legal secretary. This system worked like a charm until I found a chink in the scheduling armor meant to keep me safe. As it turns out, that mostly meant keep me safe from myself. My sister and I were two of a half dozen kids watched by an old woman who kept one eye on a small television sitting on the kitchen counter, and the other on the street outside the dining room window beyond in an effort to pick up gossip-worthy happenings in the neighborhood outside. Thick curls of cigarette smoke did little to improve her field of view, leaving massive holes along the backside of the home for a mischievous youngster with way too many brain cells for his own good and no inherent sense of caution or restraint. I could see the sitter puffing away from my position on the living room floor, head down and eyes wide open. A thin ribbon of light marked the bottom edge of the curtains, hiding sliding glass doors that led to the backyard and freedom. The other children, safely in dreamland, lay scattered throughout the dark space. I wiggled backwards until I was free of my blanket's warm embrace. A quick peek at the kitchen showed my movement had gone unnoticed. I crawled through the shadows near a credenza, butt down and mostly hidden by the other kids nearby. Keeping a wary eye on our jailer, I slipped into the darkness beyond the living room before standing up and easing down the hallway. I grabbed my backpack where it hung on a hook at the front door. Reversing course, I made it back to my blanket undiscovered and tucked it inside the pack alongside two apples, a comic book, and a flashlight for the journey in case it got dark before I found my dad. The sitter remained immersed in whatever game show ABC played in the early afternoon, so I slipped behind the curtain covering the sliding glass doors, clicked open the lock, and made my escape into the alley beyond the backyard fence. My mom later told me the escape didn't go unnoticed for very long. Within half an hour, the sitter had counted sleeping heads and found one missing. 2 seconds after that, she was speaking with the 911 operator, who quickly relayed that information to the Frisco Police Department. One of their officers found me on the eastbound ramp of I-70 heading towards Denver, my thumb stuck out in hope of a ride. I was promptly delivered to the law offices where my mom worked before being returned to the babysitter's house to wait out the long afternoon with my fellow prisoners. It would not be my last escape attempt. So, chapter 2. Hope you liked that. Number 15. learning to be single at 45. So, the whole reason I ended up in Minneapolis in the first place was because my son's mom, my ex-wife, Heather, was from here. She went to high school here. So when, even though we had a kid and I wrote an autobiography, it didn't fix what was wrong with us. So she said she would like to move back to where she was from, and I didn't really care. I just wanted to be near my son. So we came here to Minneapolis. I didn't know anybody, met a couple people and just started, whatever, got involved at the VFW and met some more people there and, have a little social circle of friends. Had a pretty decent gig for a couple years. Then they decided to get rid of the division I was in, tried to start my own business last year, which led to the long-term unemployment that I thought was solved by this contract that I just got released from after 2 months, basically. So it's been a roller coaster, to say the least, since I've been single. I mean, we were separated for well over a year before we were divorced, or actually separated for 2 years, and then divorced, I guess, for a little over a year. But what that really means is I had to learn to be single at a fairly advanced age. And I don't know, I guess I'm good at it. I guess I'm not good at it. I'm good at it in that I enjoy my alone time. Thank goodness, because there's a lot of that. And I enjoy my about time too, you know, and trying to figure out, you know, what to say, when to say it, who to say it to, all the normal stuff. So I'll keep figuring it out. Oh my goodness. But I don't think it's any easier or harder at any age versus another age. You know, I was happy that this person who I loved deeply and still consider one of my best friends, that we were able to separate in such a way that left us both whole and actually left us both way better than we were before we got together. Not a lot of people who've gone through that can say the same. So, and my kid sees us being friendly, and we do things together, and we go to events and movies and whatever. And you know, he spends a decent amount of time with me, and you know, most of his time with her. I think we're doing a pretty good job. So, the single thing, I figure, will just figure itself out. 16. Hyperbole is a horrible filter for important decisions. And while that's certainly true of politics, we see it every day, it's also true in our personal relationships. We tend to look at most decisions through a very hyperbolic lens, in my opinion, in this country. It's been years and years since I've been overseas, but overseas, they tend to not use hyperbole as profusely as we do. At least that was true, you know, whatever, 20 years ago when I was in the military and doing a lot of traveling. We use it constantly here for everything from, you know, oh, you know, this food isn't hot enough. You know, that's the end of the world. Like, everything's the end of the world. Everything can't be the end of the world. And it's especially less helpful when it's an important decision. So, you know, it goes back to that slow down thing, right? Hyperbole is a consequence of anxiety based on the fact that you don't think you're getting what you need to be getting as quickly or as, you know, when you should be getting it. So your anger and your hyperbole is a stand-in for anger, and that is always seen as a way to sort of get what you want quicker. But it has the opposite effect. It slows. Whatever you want is less likely to come the more hyperbole you use. Leads pretty good into number 17, which is on burning bridges. Don't do that. I don't know if you're the type of person that burns bridges, but it's not an effective way to manage your interpersonal relationships in any way, shape, or form. It's really not good to do that in business relationships, right? You never know who knows someone else that you may need an introduction someday for some reason. I've done my damnedest not to burn any bridge, no matter how justified my ego says I am in doing so. So, number 18. Ooh, this is a big one. This is a recent one too. I'm sad to say it's horrible to even say that, but yes, this is a recent epiphany too. Number 18, no more C word, fellas. The ladies own this one from now on, and you know the word I'm talking about. No more, nada. It was one that I used freely, and I was always quick to say that it was gender neutral or whatever, but in this country, in America, them's fighting words. And the epiphany came. I was talking to my mom, and it just kind of I said it, and I noticed her sort of just kind of flinch like I punched her. And I just noted it, and then I thought about it, and I'm like, wow, that's like, for American women especially. And I don't know, maybe all women globally. I don't know all women globally, but for American women, it's like the N-word for black people. It's I think there's almost a one-to-one equivalent in terms of the visceral emotional reaction, and anger that comes from using that word for both parties, but each individual word. And I totally agree. So as soon as I made that connection, I'm done. Like, never, haven't said it since. And now I hear someone else say it. I'm like, ooh, oh God, ow. So anyway, now I'm afraid that is another comedian. I can't watch Jim Jefferies anymore. Just like I can't watch freaking Eddie Murphy because of all the gay jokes he made. So yeah, enough said on that. And 19, so kind of ditto for me too. I think a lot of guys, cool. My buddy Micah says he has some notes for me later. I will take those notes, my friend. Any notes anyone has, feel free to be transparent. Leave them in the chat, in real time. Maybe other people will have noticed the same thing or have some nuance that you didn't get. I'm all about freaking radical transparency. Anyway, so 19, ditto for me too. I know it's ironic because, it's supposed to be inclusive of sexual assault, but and in a lot of ways, even simple misconduct belongs under that rubric. But a lot of men, found solace in having a safe place to talk about their experiences with sexual assault. But it's not a man thing, in my opinion. And I think in a lot of women's opinions too. I've only have anecdotal evidence, but I've asked a couple women about this and they agree. So I was thinking he too, because obviously I'm a survivor. I know plenty of other survivors who are men. And he too seems supportive of me too, and it also gives, whatever. Everybody wants their own thing. Cool. There's one. So number 20, ironically. It's not ironic because I wrote all these in order on purpose. I just let you in. I'm acting all surprised, and I'm not surprised at all because I figured this out several days ago. So it's not about me, and it never has been. And sort of, anytime you lose an opportunity, like a work opportunity, even this last one, okay, yeah, it was about me for me because I wasn't expecting it and I didn't want it to happen. But in the case of this particular contract, and in case of other contracts I've had in the past, the company decides to pivot in a different way and last in, first out, that's why the contracting gig's a rough one, and I don't envy anybody who has to do that. I'm hoping I can find a day job and I can just kind of do this thing on Sunday nights. And via the blog, run my Indiegogo campaigns and have extra dough to maybe do a traveling road show with this, right? I can do this show anywhere. But it's as much as this show is currently about me, the ultimate vision for this show is not about me. My story is a stand-in for everyone's story. I'm just a fool who spent 3 years delving into a pretty. I have just a good memory for details. I just don't forget shit. So, yeah. I think you'll find it entertaining. Hopefully, every 2 weeks I'll publish three chapters and we'll chat about them and yeah. So number 21 in summary. So 42 is impossible. We usually only get half of anything we're going after anyway. I think I've kind of outlined where I hope Gems Guide might go. So that's the hashtag Gems Guide. That's the website as well, gemsguide.com, JEMS guide.com. 42, I'm not going to tell you where it's from, but if you can guess, leave some comments on the blog or on the Facebook page. It's become kind of a serendipitous number in my life. And then when I dug into the Midnight Sun manuscript that is sort of the fodder for volume one of this Guide to Being Human, I found out there was 84 pages or 84 chapters. So, you know, 42 times two. So I don't know. I look for weird little, you know, juxtapositions and things like that help me sort of let me know that I'm going in the right direction and following the red road, so to speak. All right, so how about we'll do this last chapter and yeah, we'll call it a night. Chapter 3, Witchy Woman. One thing you need to understand about my family is the oddity of our collective tale. We are an eclectic and eccentric bunch on all branches of our many trees. Some of the yarns are too fantastic to be believed. Creativity and emotion, playing in a chaotic symphony of lives, live loudly and without apology. I would doubt the stories myself had I not lived a loud and unapologetic life of my own. A collection of tall and taller tales as true as they are unbelievable. My mom's first post-dad boyfriend was Mr. Chance. That wasn't his real name, but to avoid legal complications, the only name not changing in this book is my own. The one thing I clearly remember is the man's huge 4x4 pickup truck, because I slammed my thumb in the door at a softball game and screamed bloody hell until he set me free by opening the door latch. I imagine Chance did something extra terrible to provoke my grandmother's witchy woman rage the night before we moved out of his house for good, but the finer details from my early years continue to fade. I do recall screaming adults in a heated argument and the guttural growls of a large cat, accompanied by three glowing spheres of light conjured by way of my grandma's whispered pleas to our family's spirit protectors. The spheres didn't shoot from her fingertips as much as they ballooned from tiny yellow specks over her shoulder to the size of medicine balls by the time they reached a terrified Chance, who dropped to the floor in a blubbering heap. A feeling of complete peace came over me, in odd contrast to the supernatural scene and the bear of a man turned into a whimpering pussycat by a mother of five in sensible shoes and a 50s hairdo. To this day, I don't know if I dreamed the whole thing or if it actually happened, but my mom confirms my memory of events, so maybe we're both crazy. Facing down a shotgun brandished by Chance, mostly in fear, the next day, my grandma helped pack our meager belongings and escorted us to live with the family. Mom's stepfather was presumably present, an architect and building inspector, but I have no memory of him, which I find odd given the rest of the shit packed inside my head. Mom's account of the man is horrible enough, so it is just as well that all I remember are the bright pink Pepto-Bismol tablets from our time living on his yellow school bus turned mobile home, and not much else. My first years in Colorado disappear into the mist, dimmed and dulled by the searing brightness of the events to come, when my parents decided to give it another go-around and our tiny trio picked up and moved to Alaska. I hadn't seen the place of my birth since Mom loaded me on a plane and flew me to live with my grandma 5 years earlier, just after I came into the world. I was excited to see my dad for the first time in many years and to experience something totally new. All right, so that's the third chapter of this first show of Jason Everett Miller's Guide to Being Human, chapters 1 through 3. Thank you very much for joining me. I hope you got something out of this. I hope this was fun for you. I hope to continue to tighten up the format. It's a one-man show, which, you know, eventually if I can, you know, start to generate enough revenue, I'd love to, you know, hire somebody, have a sound engineer, have a producer, have a co-host, you know, do it up the right way. I'm sure there's a better way than Hangouts. Maybe figure out a way to get a phone call in or something. Anyway, yeah, so that's the show. Thank you so much. I'll see you again in 2 weeks. So the 10th of March. Enjoy your night. Have a good one. Bye-bye. Thanks for joining me. No, you hang up. No, you hang up. Okay, bye.